side of the House refuse to admit that when the Supreme Court is not our fight-down power, that it has any power at all. We are outside the House, in the power on our side of the House is more constructive and produce better outcomes. And we're going to prove to you why accountability and results lie on our side of the House. I want to talk about two things today. First of all, how the law develops, such how do we control government assent. And second of all, how the behaviour of constitutional court when it has fight-down powers is incredibly damaging to how we develop assent. Okay, first of all, exchange is a model that does not fit in. So what you like to say are no protections or why not, okay? It is true to say that some constitutions do not have protection for those minorities, okay? If the protection does not exist, that court cannot invent that, okay? I'm going to come on to why it's wrong to assume the law is necessarily moral, okay? Courts are not just free minds, we can decide as they will on moral decisions. They have to decide in accordance with law, okay? Without specific provisions, it is not clear why they necessarily protect minorities better on their side of the house. Then they go, the constitution's a good one because it's providing grounding to the ethos of that state, okay? No, that's speaking. This ignores the nuance of different types of constitutions, okay? If we're talking about more detailed constitutions, like the German constitution, then perhaps, okay, the problem there is that the German constitutional court takes an extremely restrictive approach and slows the process in Germany. For example, that's the reason why the German constitutional court has not allowed transgender rights to become a thing in Germany, because it is not necessarily compatible with some provisions like Article 2 of their constitution. No, okay? And we think the other types of constitutions, some are very vague and idealistic, like the South African constitution, and the problem there, as I'll come on to my substantive, is that courts often steal that vagueness and expand their power to again slow the political process when progressive ideas want to trickle through. Right, now their bigger claim. They say law is moral and not making legal decisions is a necessary moral thing. It is just categorically false. Why is that? Okay, law, Madam Speaker, reflects societal norms, so like jurisprudence, it's important, right? Okay, constitutions reflect antiquated norms. Okay, they don't reflect necessarily good norms. Okay, it is not good enough for Wilmore to say, look at this like nice provision of the US Constitution. Oh, that's therefore mean that all legal decisions are moral decisions, okay? I can also counter-assert that the Canadian Constitution is really vague and actually like slows progress. So while like the US Supreme Court during slavery were very against granting that kind of freedom because it was not a provision that existed in their constitution. No, okay? Madam Speaker, they failed to prove that there's a necessary link between constitutions and morality. And without that link, their idea that it's necessarily a good check on immoral decisions that urge other people is just false, okay? And then they go UN Declaration, right? We'll miss the point of that. It's funny that he chooses a document that grants no court any strike-down power at all. And then they go, but it's true people like human rights. Like, yes, I live in the United Kingdom. We like human rights too, but as I've gone to my speech, we think the soft review mechanisms are a much better way to achieve political change. Okay? He ignores the fact that documents like the UN Declaration are part of the political process. They are one item in a matrix of factors that help to contribute to aggregating preferences to make better decisions. It's funny that he's an example. No, thank you. Let's go to substantive now. How the law develops and how we have better control of government excess on our side of the house. Okay, they say, and they kind of assert this, that constitutions are a check on the tyranny of the judge. Okay, first of all, see very much about why law is not necessarily moral, but why that is probably not true. Okay, even if that is true, we're going to prove why that is better on our side of the house. No, okay, on the scene, that without strike-down powers, the Supreme Courts are powerless to do anything to influence the political process. No, okay, we focus on that without strike-down powers, how courts have better political pressure and how soft review mechanisms are more effective for defending rights of individuals. No, thank you. Okay? Government excess, as a speaker, they ignore this, often comes not from passing really awful legislation. It comes from expanding their powers beyond which legislation already grants. Okay? You get really hard when you pass a piece of legislation saying we take the citizenship of all Jews in our country, but they get less angry and there's less chance of political backlash if the government harnesses a pre-existing piece of legislation to say we're going to lock up all of this minority, as happened in the United Kingdom with the Belmarsh case. No, thank you. Okay? In the UK with the Belmarsh case, the judicial review is a much more effective mechanism to control that excess. Okay? First of all, we think it's not the bulk of excess, because the bulk of government excess happens through expanding your power beyond which pre-existing legislation already grants. No, thank you. But even if it is legislation that's the problem, why are soft review mechanisms better? Okay? For example, the ECHR, okay? In the United Kingdom, the UK Supreme Court has power to declare legislation incompatible but not strike down with that document. Okay? Why is this good? So, for example, in the case of Goodwin, like the UK Supreme Court was able to declare legislation in the United Kingdom that denied transgender people recognition rights to be incompatible with ECHR. Okay? That was important because it pointed out a lacuna in the existing law. Okay? It also created a large amount of political pressure that elicited a change in that legislation from the British government. Okay? Why is that more powerful than a strikeout? Okay? First of all, the court could be seen as an oversight mechanism, not a meddling mechanism. Okay? If a court is seen to meddle, i.e. like stopping stuff happening that people think should generally happen, okay, the respect and legitimacy of that court is undermined, and the views of that court, when it's right down to the judiciary, are ones that are less respected than that. Okay? We think also that that sort of mechanism does enough to strike the correct balance between respecting the democratic process and the application of the legislation, and still providing a slow check. So, for example, they can declare a piece of legislation incompatible, and that's saying to the public, do you really want your government to do this? And it is acting like a sin as opposed to a war, I'll take over.
The US Constitution was formed in a state that was deeply racist and homophobic. Yeah, it's been consistently used to defend the rights of minorities since then. How does this square up again?
Categorically not true. Okay? Decisions like Hobby Lobby and Citizens United, which have been used to like expand the powers of companies to include that of religious rights so that they can oppress minorities and oppress people like women who want access to contraception, is my example by counter-assert that they don't defend minorities. I've explained to you why law is not conservative at all. Finally, let's talk about the behavior of these courts. Okay? They're often populated by legal elites. Okay? Legal elites prefer a stricter interpretation of the law. Okay? They're often usually conservative due to the background that they have. The consequence is that they are often restricted to change. They're happy to opt for strikeout legislation because they prefer to err on the side of caution. Why is that a problem, Mark Speaker? First of all, because they force legislatures to act defensively. Why is that a problem? Okay, legislatures are reluctant, and governments are reluctant, to propose progressive and radical pieces of legislation for the fear that that legislation will be struck down. Okay? Governments often prefer to save face and do not be seen as informative by passing legislation that is struck down by a Supreme Court. Okay? That is why Obama was very, very reluctant to even introduce the Affordable Healthcare Act in the first place, because of the fear that as a like, the grandstand piece of legislation of his premiership, that it will be struck down. Okay? There is also a second argument. The point is, in the case of vague constitutions, which many countries in the world have, for example, South Africa, Supreme Courts often use that vagueness, they harness it, and use it just to expand their power, okay? That happened in the example of Citizens United and Hobby Lobby, where they used the freedom of speech right to give companies like rights they shouldn't have had, okay? The problem with that, right, is that they use this broad base to slow the political process even more than is necessary, right? They use that expanded power to say no to legislation, no to change. But as you've asked about the House, courts are more legitimate and protect the rights of minorities more effectively. We're very, very happy to propose.